War II. So, couple announcements before we begin today. Of course, the bookstore is back there, so feel free to capture anything that you need. If your email has changed, or if you haven't been here before and you're not on the email list, please give us your name and email address so that you can get updates every week for each session. The one thing I did want to mention is in the next couple of weeks, we're going to be sending out to the email list a reading list for the second half of this series. As you know, the second half is the scientific creation model that we're going to be presenting. We're going to be presenting the currently understood creation model because, like evolution, the creation model changes from year to year as well. And so that might be a nice thing to have in your library prior to the various lectures and the various topics. So I don't think there are any other announcements, so why don't we get right to it. Well, tonight we're going to be looking at the seventh session, the final session in the first half of the series, entitled Jurassic Park Creation Style. And of course you know and have figured out already that the title of this presentation is taken from the movie Jurassic Park. There were a lot of interesting things in that movie, by the way. If you remember the velociraptors, when they were looking into the kitchen window, they're hiding in the kitchen, and the velociraptors are looking in the kitchen through the windows. Do you remember what happened to the windows? They steamed up, because at the time there was a controversy as to whether these creatures were warm-blooded or cold-blooded. And so it was kind of interesting that the movie actually dealt with that controversy in that way. And so there'll be a lot of other things that we look at tonight relative to the Jurassic Park movie, though I may not make mention of it directly. So, let's go. Here we go. Okay, good. Tonight's presentation, by the way, is not an original from me. This was originally put together by a member of the Creation Science Fellowship, Stephen Rodebaugh, way back in the 80s, actually, and he presented it in a more complete form at the International Conference on Creationism. And what I was charged to do was to take that presentation and pull it into a nice PowerPoint package and present it to us this evening, and hopefully we have done that. And I've added a lot of graphics and several other a video and some other information that you might find interesting. And I believe we have the original presentation on videotape somewhere. Whoops. There we go. So we have several goals tonight. We want to ask the question, does the Bible speak of dinosaurs? I don't know if any of you have ever looked into this issue, but it's actually a fascinating issue, and we're going to answer that question tonight. Did man and dinosaurs live together? Does the Bible even hint to such a thing? And of course, were Fred and Wilma good parents in allowing their daughter Pebbles to have her pet Brontosaurus, which, by the way, was misnamed at the time because the head that they had on the dinosaurs was on top of the Brontosaurus was actually incorrect. And so they changed the name. So the real question is, were Fred and Wilma good parents? That's the question we want to answer tonight. Well, as we've done in virtually every one of these sessions in the first half, we've always mentioned the issue of hermeneutics, and I hope Dennis and I have been able to impress upon you the importance of this topic. It's more important than the topic itself, actually, because it's the machinery that you and I actually get at the text with. Okay, so if you and I have the machinery, then we can get everything else. We can derive the doctrine of the Trinity for ourselves, or the atonement, or what have you, the doctrine of creation. So from a logical perspective, this issue of how we understand the Bible is the most logical issue that we can discuss. It's most important, logically speaking. So the Bible is to be understood using the same rules of grammar and syntax by which it was originally written. This set of rules is called the normative hermeneutic. That's our $2 million term that we've been using these past six sessions. So what do we want to ask ourselves tonight with regard to hermeneutics? Given that the Bible's to be understood via the normative hermeneutic, we conclude then that the earth is young and that man lived with the creatures that are both extant, that is, living today, and extinct, that no longer exist, such as the dodo bird. This, of course, includes the great dinosaurs. So the issue we want to actually address tonight is, does the Bible speak of man and dinosaur living together? And the answer to that question, as you might expect, is a big whopping yes. It actually speaks of dinosaurs, as we will see. Job 40 talks about this creature called the great behemoth, and that'll be one of them that we look at. And then Job 41 discusses the great leviathan, and that'll be the second one that we look at tonight. So these two great chapters in the book of Job speak of these incredible creatures that you and I only find in the fossil record. Now, I'm kind of giving the whole package away by saying that, but we kind of have to do that to give us an idea of where we're heading. By the way, Job is probably the oldest book in the biblical text, and it could have been written by Moses as well, but it is certainly the oldest book. So let's take a look at the great behemoth. The Hebrew word is behemoth. And here we see in Job 40, verse 15, I'll go ahead and read the text for our sake this evening. Behold now, behemoth, which I made with you. He eats grass as an ox. Now, as we read this, what we're going to do, we're going to go through and just casually look at the data that Job tells us about this creature. And we're going to identify him, because you'll be surprised how much information is actually given to us in the text, especially when we kind of unravel the Hebrew, the way the King James translates some of the Hebrew is a little bit unusual. Lo now, his strength is in his loins, and his force is in the navel of his belly. He moves his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his stones are wrapped together. His bones are as strong as pieces of iron. His bones are like bars of iron. He is chief of the ways of God. He that made him can make his sword to approach unto him. Surely the mountains bring him forth food, where all the beasts of the field play. He lies under shady trees, in the covert of the reed and fens. The shady trees cover him with their shadow, and willows of the brook compass him about. Behold, he drinks up a river, and hastes not. He trusts that he can draw up Jordan into his mouth. He takes it with his eyes. His nose pierces through snares. So let's take pieces of each one of these verses and try to glean out, pull out the information that might help us identify who this and what this creature is. Well, first of all, this idea of beholding, it's a figure of speech called an asterismos. And generally, any time you see in your Bible, it says behold. That's a figure of asterismos, where the writer is telling you and I to pay close attention to what he's about to tell us in the text. Okay, and that's exactly what Job is doing here for us. So this is the attention grabber. Pay close attention to the details of what I'm about to tell you. Then, of course, the creature's name that he is about to talk about is behemoth. And it happens to be in the plural. And it should have been translated as beasts. And then, of course, the Hebrew word which is translated from Asher and is singular, but modifying the plural subject behemoth. And when you see this construction in this way, unlike Genesis 1, when you see this construction, it's called a figure of speech called plural of majesty. And it's a way in which you refer to something in a majestic or a grandiose way. And I can give you a cultural example for all you people that might be over 50. Recall the TV show Bewitched. Everybody remember the show Bewitched? Well, one of the episodes on that show, somehow Samantha brought back to the 20th century Queen Elizabeth. And if you remember the episode, Queen Elizabeth was rather angry at that she was brought out of her own time and into the 20th century, despite the fact she died in 1903, I guess it was, or 1901. So she did make it into the 20th century. And when kind of referring to the fact of her displeasure of being brought into Samantha's world, she said, "We are not amused." She was referring to herself by the figure of speech called a plural of majesty, and referring to herself, a singular person, in the plural. And so that's kind of the same idea here. All right. The phrase, "which I made with ye," God is telling Job that this creature he is discussing was made on the same day that man was made. Okay, so Behemoth then is a land creature. Okay, so that little bit of information there kind of starts to focus it down as to which creature this is. In fact, as we will see, he's the largest land creature that God made. So which animal, extinct or extant, fits this description? Well, we're also told that Behemoth eats grass like an ox, so he's a plant eater. Okay, he's an herbivore. His strength is in his loins, and the force is in his belly. Okay, so this guy has extremely powerful hip joints, and his lower body is massively strong. And so that's kind of some information that we can bring to bear. Now, this is a fun little issue here. His tail is like a cedar tree. It's from the Hebrew word erez. And if you remember, as you go through the Old Testament, there's a phrase that's often used as the Israelites are going through the Promised Land, as they're building temples and so on. They talk about the cedars of Lebanon. And these cedar trees are, maybe very small, roughly the size of this pencil, right, or pen. Well, in fact, you would think that, given what some people think this animal is. These cedar trees can be as large as 8 feet in diameter and 130 feet high. And this creature that we're told that we're being discussed has a tail that's similar to a cedar tree. So I would argue that it's probably not some of the creatures that have been given as an explanation for these verses. So here's an example. Some have claimed that Behemoth is a hippopotamus. Well, we can rule this out fairly quickly. Does his tail really look like a cedar tree? Well, here it is right there. So I hardly think that even the largest of hippopotamus is satisfying this criteria. Hardly their tails are like the great cedar tree of Lebanon. Okay, so we can rule out hippopotami. Okay. All right. Verse 17 discusses the sinews of his stones are wrapped together. Now, this is another very interesting verse. Sinews comes from the Hebrew word gidai, and it's plural, so it's cords. And the word stones comes from the Hebrew word pekhado. It's masculine, and it's plural, so it should have been translated, however, as fear. Okay, that's actually what it means, fear. But in this case, it means fears, or the sinews of his fears. Now, what makes this so interesting is the fact that these fears, so to speak, are wrapped together or are enwrapped. What this is talking about is Behemoth's testicles are internal. Now, you might think, well, why is this so significant? Well, in Genesis, God gives the command to man as well as every beast to fill the earth, right? Well, one of the things that male creatures need to do to perform that activity is they need to be healthy, right? And what needs to be done is that sperm needs to be properly maintained at the right temperature. So creatures that have testicles outside of their body, when the body gets cold, what happens? They're pulled up to the body to get warmth. When they get hot, they are let down or away from the body. But these testicles are inside the creature. Okay? So what's the significance of that? Well, we just read about the tail like a cedar tree, right? In order for this guy, this creature, to properly maintain the temperature of his organs, he needs some kind of a plumbing system to do that. So what these creatures have, just very similar to other creatures, they have an incredible plumbing system that goes out into the tail and back. So it goes out into the tail, the fluid gets cooled down, comes back to his internal organs and cools them off. So this is really remarkable because it's very similar to many creatures that are alive today with this same kind of biology. Alrighty. So essentially there are three orders of animals that have internal testicles. Birds, amphibians, and reptiles. So the question is, which one is behemoth? Well, birds were created in the fifth day, and we know that whatever behemoth is, he was created in the sixth day because that's when Job was created, right? And adult amphibians are typically not plant eaters, so he can't be an amphibian. A friend of mine had had several African bullfrogs, and they were probably that size. And his favorite meal were other frogs. So we would go down to the creek or the pond and look for frogs and take them back up and let the African bullfrog have his dinner. So behemoth is a reptile and the largest land creature God ever created. Now, here we see some more interesting things about the biology of this creature. His bones are as strong as brass. Strong is translated from aphiki, which actually means hollow tubes. So his bones are actually hollow. They're pneumatic, okay? But they're still as strong as brass. His bones, that is, other bones, are like bars of iron. Other bones are heavy and strong. So what this makes behemoth is both buoyant and strong. So this creature is rather unique. And as we look at some graphics here just a little bit later, we'll see that that is, in fact, the case on many of these creature types. Verse 19 states that behemoth is the chief of the ways of God. And, of course, this description of him complements the plural of majesty that's used to describe him in verse 15. He's the largest of God's creatures. He's the most impressive. Behemoth is the greatest of all land creatures. Behemoth is God's showpiece of creation because of his massive size. He that made him can make his sword to approach him. Well, what does that mean? Well, that means only God can kill behemoth. Weapons of Job's day are ineffective against behemoth. So no one in Job's day can kill him. Okay, now I want to make a comment about this phrase because this is where the so-called hermeneutic comes to play in a very important way. If you and I maintain that everything in Scripture is related to us, we've just arrived at a contradiction because you and I actually have weapons that can kill behemoth. In fact, hunters, if they have a nice hunting gun, take about 5 or 6 shots, but you can kill them. But not in Job's day. Today we could. So the point is that we have to understand the biblical text within the context of the original audience. How would the original audience understand that? And so no weapons during Job's day could kill behemoth. If you remember what we read in verses 20 through 22, behemoth has a massive appetite and lives in and around dense and heavily shaded marshes, swamps, and bodies of water. That's where a lot of vegetable matter is, because if you remember, he's an herbivore. Behold, he drinks up a river and hastes not. He trusts that he can draw up Jordan into his mouth. So he's not afraid of choking. He can handle it. Behemoth's mouth is protected against choking and drowning. Now, how can that be? Because certainly you and I are not protected. Well, behemoth doesn't breathe through his mouth, and his nostrils are not located near his mouth. That would be the only way that he could just sit in a flood and let the water rush in and have nothing to worry about. He takes it with his eyes, his nose pierces through snares. A better translation might be this: shall any take him in his eyes or pierce through his nose with snares? Again, man of Job's day cannot kill behemoth. So he is a rather impressive creature and one who is just absolutely massive. And if you can't kill him, you're probably more than likely not going to be able to catch him. Whereas we today could catch behemoth. It'd be an interesting feat, actually, but we could do it. So, what kind of creature, extant or extinct, fits the description for us by inspiration in Job 40, 15 through 24? Now, I know, we all know the answer to that, but I thought I'd put it in red letters anyway. The great sauropod kind. The great dinosaurs of the Jurassic. Let's take a look at some of them. Let's take a look at Brachiosaurus. The largest Brachiosaurus was about 56 metric tons and 85 feet in length. And this next picture is rather, take a look first of all at the guy standing there and the top of Brachiosaurus's head, and you can kind of get it, and just picture yourself there seeing this guy come at you. And so here we have Brachiosaurus, and man's looking up at him about, maybe 40 feet above the 6 foot guy. Now notice that his lower bones are massive. They're the solid bones. His hollow bones are his vertebrae. And of course he's got his internal organs. And notice above in his head, he has this bony dome, which is where his nostrils are and his eyes are there as well. So he can literally stand on the bottom of a lake or a river, a pond, and keep his head above water and be completely submerged and still be able to see and breathe. And so that's kind of a unique feature of behemoth. And we have many examples of this sort of biology, this sort of biomorphology in the fossil record. Brachiosaurus is just one of them. The Camisaurus, the chambered lizard, this is an interesting one because it's explicitly named after his pneumatic ability. The largest that's been found is 52 tons. Now that's 52 times 2,000. That's 104,000 pounds. 75 feet in length, and his vertebrae are hollow. Isn't that interesting? So we find in the fossil record that which corresponds to the book of Job. So what we want to do, you know, if we were just starting paleontology, the way in which we should approach it is, let's take the biblical text and go look for this out in the field if we can find it. Okay, we're going to see on Leviathan that there's actually data in the biblical text, in the biblical record, that gives us more information than we find in the fossil record. And this is what Camisaurus kind of looked like. Again, notice the bony dome on his head with his eyes. He again can stand on the bottom of a lake or a river and keep his eyes and nostrils above the surface of the water and still breathe. Now we come to Supersaurus. He's 40 tons, roughly 30 meters in length, 102 feet. And this is kind of what he looked like from the fossil record. The horizontal hollow vertebrae with a solid bony feet, and he again would be very, very stable. So the idea of having solid bones and hollow vertebrae provides a unique capability for this creature. He's very stable in the water, yet he's buoyant. Okay, so this is a very good testimony to the authenticity of Scripture. Then the largest, I believe, dinosaur that is among these is Argentinosaurus. 110 tons, 220 pounds, 20,000 pounds, remarkable, 130 feet in length, one of the largest sauropods ever found, and this is what he might have looked like. Again, notice the bony dome and the eyes above with the nostrils. So these are creatures that fit every one of the criteria that we're given in the book of Job. Okay? So this, I would conclude, best fits the picture of the creature described in Job chapter 40, Behemoth, one of the sauropods. Dino in the Flintstones, actually, because Brontosaurus would fit this as well, I suppose, but he might be a little bit smaller than these guys. I'm not sure if you'd want these guys as a pet. All right, let's look at the great Leviathan. Is there anybody here who is interested in economics? Okay. There's a lot of works that refer to Leviathan, right? A lot of books in the field of economics that refer to Leviathan. And the reason, and there's a reason for that, which we will see. So, and maybe if three or four slides remind me if I don't bring it up then, and we'll talk a little bit about it. The great Leviathan is seen in chapter 40, verses 1 through 34. I will not read all of it. I will read some of it, though. And it comes from the Hebrew word Leviathan. That's how you pronounce that, Leviathan. Notice, remember the context of Job. God is challenging Job. Who are you? I made these guys, and you can't even kill these guys, let alone capture them. Who are you? Okay. He says, can you draw out Leviathan with a hook or his tongue with a cord which you let down? Can you put a hook into his nose or bore his jaw through with a thorn? Will he make many supplications to you? I love that phrase when you understand. Will he speak soft words to you? Will he make a covenant with you? Will you take him for a servant forever? Then jump down, verse 7, can you fill his skin with barbed iron or his head with fish spears? Lay thine hand upon them, remember the battle, do no more. Behold, the hope of him is in vain, shall not one be cast down even in the sight of him? None is so fierce that dare stir him up. Who then is able to stand before me? Who has prevented me that I should repay him? Whatsoever is under the whole heaven is mine. I will not conceal his parts, nor his power, nor his comely parts. Who can discover the face of his garment, or who can come to him with his double bridle? Who can open the doors of his face? His teeth are terrible round about. That's a little bit of a rhyme there in the Hebrew. His scales are as pride, shut up together as a close seal. Let's see. They are joined to one another. They stick together that they cannot be sundered. And then finally, by his kneesings, verse 18, a light doth shine, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. Out of his mouth goes burning lamps, and sparks of fire leap out. Out of his nostrils goes smoke, as out of a seething pot or cauldron. His breath kindles coal, and a flame goes out of his mouth. In his neck remains strength, and sorrow is turned into joy before him. The flakes of his flesh are joined together. I guess I am going to read it all. They are firm in themselves. They cannot be moved. His heart, and check this out, his heart is as firm as a stone. Yes, as hard as a piece of the nether millstone. When he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid by reason of breakings. Remember this phrase, they purify themselves. The sword of him that lays at him cannot hold, the spear, the dart, nor the habergeon. I forget how to pronounce that. He esteems iron as straw and brass as rotten wood. The arrow cannot make him flee. Sling stones are turned with stubble in with him into stubble. Darts are counted as stubble. He laughs at the shaking spear. Sharp stones are under him. He spreads sharp pointed things upon the mire. He makes the deep to boil like a pot. He makes the sea like a pot of ointment. He makes a path to shine after him. One would think the deep be a hoary. Upon earth there is not his like, who is made without fear. He beholds all things. He is the king over the children or the sons of pride. So, that is his description of this creature called Leviathan or Leviathan. Massive creature and a very fearful creature. All right, Leviathan is translated from the Hebrew Leviathan. From the root of Lava, meaning to take, which is related to the word family Levi, and the Levites were the Jewish priests that were to take tithes from the nation, right? They weren't giving a portion of the land, they were given cities. Okay, so they're the ones who are to take the tithes from the people. So they were the takers, literally. And so they're kind of named after Leviathan. The creature described herein is clearly unique, just absolutely incredible. Leviathan is the greatest predator Job ever saw or knew. So the question then is, what creature, extant or extinct, satisfies this criterion of being the greatest predator of all time? Okay, I did say I was going to remember something. Oh yes, economics. The reason why there's a lot of, in economics discussions, this term Leviathan is used, is because government takes your taxes and mine. So they are Leviathan. They are Leviathan. Anybody that takes something from someone is a taker. Okay, so that's why in economics textbooks you'll see this term Leviathan often used. It has to do with taking. I make no political or economic comment on that. I just thought if you read a lot of economics books, you might be interested in that. Leviathan cannot be trifled with, captured, tamed, or killed by men or weapons of Job's day. Well, this would exclude Leviathan being a crocodile. With the weapons of Job's day, you could kill a crocodile. And given the description of Leviathan, I hardly think that crocodile would satisfy much of the criteria of this chapter. Verses 3 and 4 emphasize that Leviathan does not negotiate, compromise, or back down. He is exceedingly fierce, aggressive, and implacable. And this, of course, is compared with the heart as hard as a millstone, which we talk a little bit about later. Leviathan is a land-based animal. No man or creature dares to disturb Leviathan. He kills anyone he desires. The mere sight of Leviathan takes away all hope. Okay? God alone can kill Leviathan. Man of Job's day have no hope of killing him. The word parts is better translated supporting limbs, and power seems to be the main phrase of verse 12. Okay? And there is a figure of speech called an intro, or actually a grammatical construction in that verse, called an introversion. And an introversion is similar to what we find in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, where Paul goes through and tells us what our doctrinal statement is supposed to be, you know, for the church today, for there's one body, one faith, one hope, and so on. Well, that is in a form of an introversion, where the first element is related to the last, the second to the last, the third to the last, and so on. And it's the same thing here. And the whole idea is that this creature is a very balanced individual. And being well-balanced and powerful suggests that Leviathan is bipedal. Take a look at how coordinated, how quick a crocodile is on land. Anybody in this room can run away from a crocodile. but not from Leviathan. And the only way that could be is if he was bipedal and well-balanced. He could turn very quickly, despite how large he might be. Are crocodiles well-balanced on land? Hardly. Leviathan cannot be skinned with the tools of Job's day. His scales, his skin, his muscles are remarkable. His hide is incredibly thick and impenetrable. Now, this is kind of fun. His double bridle refers to his double row of teeth, and it refers to his upper and lower teeth. His permanent smile seemingly laughing at his prey. So keep that in mind, that when he sees something in front of him that he likes, he's going to be smiling. And why not? He has the face the size of doors. And this, of course, refers to the size of his mouth. His terrible teeth all around rhymes with the double row of teeth in verse 13 in the Hebrew text. That's kind of something to keep in mind. Now, the description of Leviathan is that he actually can breathe fire. The text actually says that he sneezes this sort of material. Neezings, if you remember when we read it, neezings is an old word for sneezing. So Leviathan has the capability of sneezing fire. His eyes are orange-like or reddish, one of the colors of the sunrise. So Leviathan spits fiery torches or lamps out of his mouth. From his nostrils comes smoke, the aftermath of the sneezes and spittings. So the way in which Leviathan is described in the text, it clearly states he has this capability. He truly is a dragon. Now, we've been all taught that these dragons are kind of mythical, and King Arthur killed the last one back in 800 or what have you, however you want to kind of read the mythological literature. But we're kind of told that these are all myth. But it clearly describes this creature as being a dragon-like creature. Furthermore, fire-breathing further indicates that Leviathan is land-based. If he was water-based, there'd be no hope of him breathing fire. Can you imagine a fish breathing fire? Hardly. Well, these dragon legends are all over the world, and every culture has one. In fact, I would recommend just going onto Google or Wikipedia, do a search on dragon legends, and you'll come up with many, 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 many links in virtually every culture around. The Nagu is the Indian Hindu, is the dragon from the Hindu culture. Draco, which we're probably all familiar with, is the European fire-breathing dragon, related to King Arthur and the guys. Then the Scandinavian, the Viking dragon, is called Lindworm. And the Aztec dragon is this Cuicotol. I had that pronounced at one time. I don't speak Aztec. But he's, of course, associated with fire. So all these guys are associated with fire, essentially. It's not so unbelievable that this creature could have existed. Today we have a creature called the bombardier beetle. Maybe we're all familiar with him. And he has fire flatulence. Now this is rather remarkable. And his flatulence is created by two chemicals mixing together, hydroquinone and hydrogen peroxide. And these chemicals mix in a third chamber and are expelled at an incredible rate of about 500 pulses per second. And the temperature of this reaction is about 212 degrees. Believe me, I have thought about doing this at home, trying to mix these two chemicals together. Yeah. But I haven't done it yet, so I'll let you know if I do. Here's the bombardier beetle. You can kind of see the sacs where the chemicals are created, and then you can see the green sacs where each of these chemical compounds are stored. Then when the bombardier beetle needs to take care of himself, he squeezes these two chemical compounds into this explosion chamber that the graphic calls it, and then he spits it out of his rear. And this gas, of course, it comes out as roughly boiling and somewhat caustic. So that's the bombardier beetle. We have these, by the way, in this area here. They are in Pennsylvania in this area, and there's many, many different species of bombardier beetle. So we're going to come back to that later. The text says in verse 22 and 23, his powerful neck is required for his door-sized mouth. And that stands to reason. If your jaws are 5 feet in length, you're going to need a pretty strong neck. Okay? And so it stands to reason that the description of Leviathan is going to be described as having a very strong and powerful neck. Sorrow is turned into joy before him, referring to his double-rowed teeth and his permanent smile. The flakes of his flesh, namely his muscles, are firm and joined together. He is the Arnold Schwarzenegger, if you will, of these creatures. And, of course, this is again related back to what is talked about Leviathan in verse 13. So he's extremely strong, well-coordinated, the kind of thing you don't want to mess with. Now, this is another interesting characteristic of Leviathan. It says his heart is as firm as a stone, as a millstone. And one of the interesting things about a millstone is what the folks used to use to grind their grain and so on, right? So it's a very hard rock. But it was also something that they used to grind up other softer rocks. So it's to make talcum and so on. So the millstone is very, very hard, and that is the stone that's being used to describe Leviathan with regard to having no mercy, he takes no prisoners, and he does not negotiate. So he takes what he wants, and that's why he's called Leviathan, the great taker. And of course, this reflects back to verse 2, where it says he doesn't negotiate, and verse 10 gives us good advice. Don't bother him. Leave him alone. So in concert with verse 34a, when Leviathan rises up, he beholds all things. And what this kind of gives us the impression of then is that he can hold that position for some time. So he can rise up and take a look at what's around him, and does he see any food, perhaps? So he's a rather unique creature in that regard. Together with his power and bipedal nature, Leviathan can turn very quickly, completely unlike a crocodile. And it even says that the mighty ones, the great warriors, are terrified of Leviathan. So the greatest of Navy SEALs would be terrified at Leviathan. It states that the mighty ones purify themselves. Now, this is a figure of euphemy. Remember how we talked about euphemy before? This means they lose control of their bodily functions when they see Leviathan, because they know their time is up and they are toast. Even the greatest warriors lose control. Compare all hope is in vain in verse 9 with this idea of losing control. No one can stand before him. So it's a rather stark sight to see Leviathan see you in his sights. So the weapons of Job's day, which are enumerated as a sword, spear, dart, breastplate, javelin, arrows, slingshot, and so on, they're ineffective against Leviathan. And he is the great taker. But if you want to maintain that this creature is nothing more than an elephant being described here in Job, any one of us can kill an elephant in this room. Even with the weapons of Job's day, just give me a nice couple of spears and we can take that elephant down. It might be dangerous, it might be difficult, but we can do it. Not so with Leviathan. You can't do it. That's the whole point in the book of Job. So it can't be an elephant. Laughing at the shaking spear refers to Leviathan's doubled road teeth and his permanent smile. So the idea here is he smiles when he sees dinner being served. Okay, so the other interesting thing that, and this is the piece of information that we're given in the text of Job that we're not given in the fossil record. It states that under his belly includes protrusions that make impressions in the mud. So when he hunkers down, so to speak, these protrusions make a pattern in the soil. Okay? We don't have any reference to this structure of any of these creatures in the fossil record. Okay, so it was probably some kind of cartilage material under the skin or something. It wasn't a bone, otherwise we would see it. So it's rather interesting that here's information that we're given in the biblical text that we're not given in the fossil record. And more than likely, probably we'll never find unless unless we find more soft tissue of these creatures. Okay. Leviathan, as we said, is the greatest predator. He has no equal on land. He is the greatest taker of them all. And Leviathan is the king of the sons of pride. And in this way, he typifies Satan. Okay, so it is kind of interesting that Satan is referred to as a dragon, seven-headed dragon, the ultimate of all Leviathan. And here we see the great taker here on the earth. So the identity of Leviathan. What animal, extant or extinct, best fits these remarkable characteristics of Leviathan? Well, the great and giant theropod kind. Okay. So let's take a look at one of these guys. Here we see Gigantosaurus, the great southern lizard. He's found in South America and Patagonia. His jaws are 5 feet in length, 40 feet in his, he is 43 feet in length, and he's roughly 15.2 tons. So multiply that by two. He's about 40,400 pounds. Did I say that right? But anyway, 30,000 pounds. So he's a big creature, not as big as Behemoth, but then again, Behemoth's not a taker. This guy's a taker. Now, could you imagine him coming after you with those teeth and seeing him smile at you? You would think that I'm in trouble. So let's take a look then at the next. Tarbosaurus, the alarming lizard found in Mongolia. He has also 5 foot jaw, slightly under 39 feet in length, and the largest weighed about a little over 5 tons. And there we see him on display. Notice how wide he can open his mouth. And if you recall the young gal next to the one prior to that, he could just pull her right up in a single swell and have her for dinner, not even bite down. Here we see the great Tyrannosaurus rex, T-Rex, king of the tyrant lizards, found in North America, 5 foot jaws. He's 40 feet in length. The largest that has been found thus far is almost 8 tons, that's 16,000 pounds. He's 13 feet at his hips. So he's coming, so at his hip, you've got another, for the average man who's 6 foot, you've got another 7 feet to look up to just to get to his hips. Now, what's interesting about Tyrannosaurus rex is we have found soft tissue with these guys. I don't know if you knew that, but recently there's been a great controversy over this issue. How do you deal with this? Because now we've got DNA available to us, right? The other interesting thing is that if you read some of the literature on this soft tissue, you will not see anyone challenge how they ought to think about how the Tyrannosaurus got there, how long ago. If he's been there for 65 million years, you would think there would be no soft tissue left. But there is soft tissue. Very interesting. Now, if we look at his skull, I don't recall where this skull is from. It's from Wikipedia, but I don't think this is the... there's a skull down at the Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh. But no, the reason I wanted to show this particular picture is notice the various chambers in his skull. These could have been used for some of these dragon-like characteristics. And so we don't know what these were for, but they could have been used for generating fire and various chemicals and so on. And finally, we see a picture here of another Tyrannosaurus rex with 5-foot jaws. And notice if you put skin on him and mass and everything, how actually stable he would be. His head would be balanced by his tail. And he would be, because he's bipedal, he would be very, very quick to move because he's very balanced. So unlike a crocodile, it would be very difficult to get away from Leviathan. If he sees you, you're pretty much toast. So hiding behind a tree won't do the trick either. So this is Leviathan, the great taker. Okay, let's having said all that, let's open it up and for some questions here, if we have any. Yes.